And it works well with these vertical positions because you're going to be moving straight south to that expansion. And we all know how good Vion is with those medivacs, so it should, in theory, do damage. But Lucira did a really good job with the harassment last game. So I wouldn't count out Lucira defending those medivacs with those 16 Marines, as you mentioned.
Look at how feisty he's being with that Reaper. He's like, no, you want to go get a free third base? No, you're going to have to protect that drone. Somehow, some way, you're going to have to wait for Zergling speed, and then I'll back off. Just delaying that third base as much as possible.
The Overlord speed is out for Lucira, and oh, it doesn't actually scout the tech lab that's researching Stimpak, so he probably thinks this is maybe a double medivac build or a double liberator build so far.
Yeah, doesn't have all the information. If he's done his studying on Beyond, though, he should have some idea of, oh, okay, see that reactor coming up near that starport. He could be going for this kind of build.
Yeah, once again, he is going for those two quick evolution chambers before the lair, so he wants to get that plus one upgrade for his melee units very quickly.
We are nearing that moment where the stim is going to be done, right as the two medivacs fly over to the base of the Zerg. We're just taking another look here. He did not see any of the racks.
Yeah.
He didn't see the starport in the factory.
Yeah, and the medivac timing is very neat with that stim pack timing. That once those medivacs do come out, you can immediately load your Marines, and then once you get to your opponent's base, the stim pack will be completely done.
Yeah, it's really a sick build. Look at this, a Ling's in position and it scouts both medivacs coming over, and already a big swell of Ling's are being made.
Yeah, I think Lucira was saving up lava just to see whether this timing would be coming in. If he didn't see the medivacs come from beyond, he probably would have droned up, and this is a lot of queens.
He's got six queens already. He's like, okay, you want to go? You want to fight? You're going to lose both medivacs.
Whoa, that's a sick mine. But the thing is, how many transfuses does Lucira have?
I don't think it really matters, man. You just focus down those medivacs and you push them back.
Yeah.
He did lose a couple of those queens, but he is going to defend this.
And he's going to take his third behind the attack of Bjorn as well, so we'll see how much more damage Bjorn can achieve with this timing.
Yeah, Lucira is taking this very seriously. He's sat at about 38 drones for a while and just made a bunch of lings for the defense. He doesn't want to take any damage. Of course, with this kind of build, Bjorn is forcing him to make a ton of lings, and he does have the third base behind.
Unfortunately for Bjorn, because he decided to go... Actually, hold that thought as there's a surround here from Lucira.
Gets that surround. A really nice micro here from Bjorn. And this is why this build is so strong. So many Stim Marines at this point in the game.
I love the Widow Mine as well. It just adds an extra touch of splash damage to the army composition of Bjorn. And now he's going to try and hit this third base.
See what kind of damage he can get done. That one medevac is so low on both energy and health. And a lot of those Marines are very, very low as well. Looks like he may just want to back off.
Yeah, I think he should just back off. Loses that medevac. But nice micro here from Bjorn. Tries to pick off as many Zerglings and Queens as possible before this army of Marines do die.
Yeah, looks like they're going to go down. Now they all just melt because they're so low from stimming so much. Not having enough medivacs to deal with that.
Yeah, the thought I was talking about before that Lucira or surround was that because you're getting those medivacs and stim much quickly than normal, your upgrades are going to be behind. That being said, though, Bjorn has caught up in terms of plus one. We haven't seen the plus two from Lucira come out so far, so that minor upgrade advantage from Lucira has completely gone to naught.
Yeah, he does start the plus, well, both of these players start the plus two attack for now. And we do have that Spire coming up here for Lucira. Looks like he's totally switched into the mindset that Ling Bling Muta is the way to play this matchup once again, at least against Bjorn.
And a very pesky Zergling. He's going to scout that third base, force the SUVs to transfer away from that third, even though it was a few SUVs there for Bjorn. And I like this scan here from Bjorn. He confirms that the gas is being added at third base, which means that Lucira is looking to add those Mulas to his army.
Yeah, and even the drone count as well. He's like, oh, okay, you don't have like a huge follow-up coming or anything crazy. You saw you made a bunker there just for safety, but now he kind of, with that scan, confirms that everything is normal. He's not going to all in me.
And once again, we see the Hellions come out from Bjorn. He probably wants to turn those into Hellbats to help soak up any of those Baneling hits that come when he fights the army of Lucira.
We're getting Burrow again in this game. We'll see if he can land another Burrowed Baneling. It's going to be a bit harder on this map because there's multiple different avenues to come down and it's a bigger map.
Yeah, but Beyond lost that previous game because of that really awesome Baneling hit, Baneling landmine. If Beyond doesn't get caught off guard here, he'll have more of a chance to win this game.
Yeah, and Losir is a tricky player. Uh-oh!
Oh, nice Hellions there. Very nice positioning. He knew that the Zergling run-bys were possible, and that Hellion splash damage just forces Losir away. Very nice subtle move there from Beyond.
I was kind of scared the supply depot was down, but
it was baiting the Zerglings in, which was really neat of Beyond.
That's the other thing I was thinking about. Losir is really tricky with his Baneling landmines. Perhaps he could try to beat Beyond in to one on this kind of big map.
I think a major problem here for Beyond is that the creep spread is incredible from Losir. He's halfway across the map on both the left and right side. He's taking that fourth base relatively unharassed, and Beyond's not doing anything to stop this creep spread.
He's going to start now. I like this wall. Losir has been really persistent with all the Ling run buys. You need to cut off all avenues if possible. And Beyond actually scanned the other fourth base location. So he needs to check this other fourth base to confirm that Losir is, in fact, getting that up and running now.
Yeah, we see the vehicle armor being researched from Beyond. Doesn't want those medivacs to take as much damage as he can from those mutilists, and now he starts trying to deny this creep. But Losir has a very bulky army, a lot of Banelings, a lot of Zerglings, a lot of mutilists.
And right as Beyond pushes, Baneling Speed and Fire Carapace level 1 are all going to finish here.
Yeah, this is quite an anti-timing here for Beyond, and here comes the attack here from Losir. Nice around with the Zerglings and Banelings. Banelings doing so much damage. Remember, there are no Widowmites that deal splash damage, no tanks as well.
There's so many problems with that push. You know, the Baneling Speed finishes up is one thing, but he's fighting on creep, and he has no AoE, as you keep on saying. He has no way to deal with all of those Banelings that Losir is focusing on. Losir is playing mainly Ling and Baneling style. He doesn't make that many mutas this early on. He's only got 6.
Yeah, and I have to disagree with Beyond's thought of getting those Hellbats, because he can use that factory to get those Widowmines, which are more efficient. They do splash damage to the units, and they also attack the Mutalisk.
And I think Beyond is beginning to realize that now as well, because you see he's adding in a bunch more Widowmines, and he's making 2 at a time as well. So knows he needs that AoE. He's going to try to push here again.
The only redeeming thing for Beyond here is that his +3/+3 is quite ahead of Lazura's actually, but will it matter at all? Is Lazura's trying to surround this army, and he's doing a very good job, this Mutalisk, trying to pick off these medivacs.
Way too much stuff there, and now all this stuff in the medevacs is actually in danger of going down.
He needs to drop these units.
Look at how much stuff Losir has. He's not even going to commit because he knows he's so far ahead.
Yeah, and all he needs to do is secure that fourth base and transition to Hive Tech, and he's got this game. He's even getting the Burrow onto that below the ramp.
That was right outside the range of vision,
the
too.
The worst nightmare for Beyond right now are those Burrowed Banelings, rather.
Yeah. And that's the best place to put it, too, because if you put it out further, they're probably going to scan it, but they're not going to scan right outside their vision, most likely.
Oh,
that's
my
almost
God.
Too
Look
scared
at all those
careful.
Creep tumors. That is disgusting here from Losir.
Definitely is. And he's also remaking the creep on the left side. He's been very meticulous about this.
If Losir gets these engineering bays, that's going to be huge. Because the only way Beyond can get back to this game if his +3/+3 is ahead of Losir, and it can do significant damage with it. But you see the Overseer, it's creeps, poops on the engineering base. It's going to delay that +3. At least it's armor. If it was weapons, it'd be disastrous with Beyond.
Yeah. I mean, you're exactly right. In the last game, he had that 3-3, and he was able to do some amount of work taking out the natural. But this time, on a much bigger map, he never really got the pressure on any of these bases because he took a couple of big fights not in his favor.
Oh, here we go. Let's see if he scans. No, he doesn't.
No scan. Losir, though.
But he actually just goes to the side, which is really unfortunate for Losir. Yeah. If there were a few pixels to the right, it could have done a lot of damage. And he scans right now.
There you go. Guess maybe Losir unburrowed those, tried to go for the chase, and then burrowed them again, perhaps. That's why he knew they were there.
So many Banelings here from Losir, and Losir is one of those players that isn't afraid to get a lot of Banelings because he's very good at controlling him, He can get the most out of those Banelings, and with the situation Beyond is, I'm not surprised that he's doing that.
Look at all these run bys once again. Lucera is playing like a Zerg god. He's really just channeling, you know, that fantastic play of all the best Zergs that we've seen in the past.
Yeah, and with Bjorn, I'm really surprised that we haven't seen those drops that we are so accustomed to from him. He's just very scared that those drops that he wants to do will be shut down by the Mutalisk of Lucera.
Yeah, and that's a really good point because generally we don't see this Mutalisk style all too often.
Oh, not. Actually, that's quite a number of Banelings hitting that Marauder, unfortunately, for Lucera, but...
He's kind of just running them in, and there's no defense! He needs to lift! And this
SCV's well.
Is all alone! There's no defense here!
I don't know why he's scanned. There's a turret there. I guess Bjorn panicked quite hard, but this is actually a lot of Liberators.
Yeah, and this is a decent amount of Mutas, but if you fight with the Marines and the Liberators, you probably... are going to win that fight if none of this other Zerg army is around.
Yeah, the question is for Bjorn is that how many Liberators do you want to deploy to deal with the ground army of Lucera, and how many Liberators do you want to have to deal with the Mutalisk? Oh, that's actually quite wasteful there from Lucera. A lot of... Actually, hold that thought. Is we see a lot of Corruptors here. Dark style here.
So many Corruptors added into the mix. Lucera just has so much stuff at this point. Triggers the Widowmine even with one of those Corruptors.
Yeah, I think the main problem here for Lucera is that he's very scared of what these Liberators are going to do, and we're going to see an engagement.
Here we go. The Corruptors getting to work against those Liberators in the back. Decent splits here from Bjorn, but just way too many Banelings. A big follow-up, though, from Bjorn. And does Lucera have enough to fight that bio?
Way too much air army here from Lucera. He can just mop up those Liberators, and here come more Banelings, and another stim has to be used from Bjorn.
Look at how much of Lucera's supply, though, is in those Corruptors. He dealt with all the Liberators, but now he needs to deal with these Marines. Bjorn's army is very, very small. He has no more medevacs even in the sky. But Lucera needs to regroup here.
Just look at the money count of Lucera. He's just trying so desperately to try and defend from this attack, but I don't think he has any lava to make up for it as well as the mineral count.
You can see he's got a bunch of Lings, and he's trying to fight with them, and now the drones as well.
These Corruptors are completely useless, but it does mop up this army of Bjorn with his Mutalisk, and Bjorn is forced to move back.
Yeah, the fact that he keeps 16 Mutas alive is huge. He may just be able to win the game from this. Bjorn only now getting this fourth base up, and there's only one turret.
Yeah, only one turret. And GG.
GG, that's going to be it. Lucera taking the 2-0 over Bjorn. Coming in with the boom here.
Yeah, very impressive play there from Lucera. Surprising me with his Mutalisk Banelink style. Seems like he's very comfortable with that, and as a result, he did take the victory, and now he advances to the winner's match where he faces either Classic or Seed.
That is huge for Lucera. He actually said in his interview that he was not confident against Terran. He's confident against the two Protoss players in the group. So now that he takes a 2-0 over Bjorn, he must be feeling really confident in himself.
Yeah, sure, and unfortunately for Bjorn, didn't really show the play that we're so accustomed to in the online leagues, and as a result, it does get knocked down to the losers match.
Lucera getting the cheering on from his coach, probably just going over the games once again. You can see he's got a big smile on his face and seems just really happy in general about his win there.
Yeah, and Lucera, as I mentioned, very impressive.
Yeah, for sure. Well, guys, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to jump into that PvP Seed versus Classic. Stay tuned.
Good. 깨끗하게 피어나라고 겨울을 이겨낸 봄꽃이 내게 말했다. 맑고 깨끗한 칠성사이다.
Ay, 짬뽕이네. 근데 어디서 시킨 거예요?
그거 시킨 거 아닌데. 어떻게 볶음 진짬뽕인데?
어떻게 볶음 진짬뽕?
볶음 진짬뽕. 볶음 진짬뽕.
와,
정말로 화끈하네.
볶음 진짬뽕 외에는 절대 현혹되지 마소.
진짜 괜찮네. 라이크 좋아. 좋아요. 야, 이거는 내 거네. 이거 스노우웹에서 내 쓰라고 이거 만들었네.
채팅창 폭동 일으키지 마!
봉준이는 애인을 극구하고 있어요. 에, 우리 러머디 형님들 많은 분들 스노우웹 어플 깔아주셔서 지금 라이브 채팅에 도전해주세요.
앙앙 러머디? 러머디?
토끼 고양이 이러고 실시간으로 라이브야. 기능 굉장히 좋지 않냐 스노우웹?
괜찮은 것 같아.
우리 스노우웹 때문에 배꼽 째겠다.
여러분 안녕하세요. 짬짜면 복짜면 복짜면 복탕 뭐 탕복밥 먹다가 고추 잡채, 소프트 크림, 향나기, 전가복, 유린기. 아 이게 어디로 먹어야 될지 막 지금 막 그걸 뒤집힙니다. 체지방이 쌓이기 전에 그리고 콜레스테롤이 쌓이기 전에 이렇게 먹으면서 관리를 하는 거죠. 메타그린과 함께 또 맛있는 먹방 또 진행하도록 하겠습니다. 안녕. 우리 여러분 건강해져요. 밥 먹으면서 안녕.
거의 게임 마스터. 무슨 게임을 하더라도 뭐 기본 이상.
네. 지금 그걸 연습할 때가 아닙니다.
그렇습니다. 이렇게 하는 거예요. 이겼나?
이겼나 이거?
추가 시간. 좋아 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 좋아.
자리야 킬.
파이팅! 아, 아.
드디어 드디어.
소나님이랑 닮았다는 소리를 아, 듣는데
네네네.
LW팀 소개합니다. 저를 키우는 게 보통이 아니거든요. 파이팅! 나이스! 공 한번 쓰죠.
어, 한번 죽였어.
나이스!
와! 이겼어. 야! 어디?
게임 방송에서도 할 의향이 있어.
방패 정도는.
아, 우리 범 선수에 다시 한번 박수 주면서.
진짜 박수를 한번.
이거 팀장 미팅이냐?
이게 뭐라 그러지? 긴장이 되죠?
느낌 왔어! 자, 들어가자. 지금이네! 마무리야!
오버워치
파이팅!
오호, 물로 지금 거의 뭐 수분을 그냥 갖다 들이붓는 것 같아요. 자, 바른 쪽과 안 바른 쪽입니다. 차에 보여드릴게요. 내가 발라봤는데 대표네. 앞으로 그냥 나도 찍어 발라야 될 것 같아요. 잘 봐요. 자, 이렇게 깔끔하게 아래쪽만 다듬어도 선이 딱 살아있잖아요. 선 라인 같아요. 잠깐만.
오, 이런 느낌이구나. 허허.
오늘 여러 가지 제품들 올리브영에서 제가 지금 제품을 받아서 사용을 해봤는데 굉장히 좋은 것 같아요. 올리브영 제품이 짱입니다.
립스틱이나 이런 거 넣고 오잖아? 그러면 오버장이 너무 떴네 이러면서 이거 뭐 모르겠다 맞아. 거의 진짜 생 걸로 갔다가 풀메이크로 보고 나올 수가 있어. 거기는 미스트부터 뿌려야 돼.
갈게요.
짠! 뭔 색이 제일 이뻐요?
나 예뻐?
예뻐.
한 군데서 해결할 수 있으니까 네, 올리브영 한 번씩 가보셔도 여러분 좋을 것 같아요.
올리브영을 통해 새로운 사람으로 태어난 것 같아요.
미소가 생기다. 화사함이 생기다. 건강한 하루가 생기다. pH 8.0과 풍부한 미네랄로 핑크빛 생기가 생기다. 아이시스 8.0. 이제 모두 핑크하세요.
답답할 때 마셔봐요. 트로피카나. 상큼상큼 과일 듬뿍 스파클링.
리얼 프루트를 스파클링으로.
과즙이 톡톡 쏜다. 트로피카나 스파클링.
상쾌하면 되는 거야. 상쾌함의 높이가 다르다. Stylish Sparkling Water, Lotte Trevi.
봄꽃에게서 듣다. 있는 그대로 맑고 깨끗하게 피어나라고 겨울을 이겨낸 봄꽃이 내게 말했다. 맑고 깨끗한 칠성사이다.
2016 Hot 6 GSL Season 2 Code X.
GSL Codes Group C down here with Valdez and DTR filling in tonight. Lucira taking the 2-0 over Beyond and then a surprise victory there.
Yeah, and they were very convincing games from Lucira. Like, pretty much countered what Beyond was doing and completely wrecked Beyond. We expected Beyond to be one of the favorites to get out of the group, but Lucira showing that he still has that form in him to make it out.
Yeah, he does this sometimes. Maybe the GSL is where he feels most comfortable because he got to the round of eight last season, higher than anyone else in this group did last season. So, feeling good there. But we are going to jump into the second match, Seed versus Classic.
Yeah, Seed, he did play twice in the previous round. I mean, he passed so many games, but he did lose to SOS and Deal. Let's face it, SOS and Deal, there's no shame to losing those players.
Two fantastic Protoss players, great in the matchup too, PvP. Did also take a 1-2 loss against Scarlet there in the SSL Season 2 qualifiers, so I believe he did get knocked out.
Yep, and as we mentioned before, Seed, we don't really see him too often in Pro League, so it's really going to be interesting to see how well he'll do. And here we have Classic. We've got two GSL champions facing against each other. It's hard to like, say that because you don't really associate them with championships, do you?
Well, we definitely do for this guy, Classic.
Yep, SSL and GSL champion.
Yeah, for sure. Did lose to Stats, Maru, Bumiho. All fantastic players that are really on top of their game right now, so no
and,
shame
and
in
the
that.
Game against Maru was crazy.
Oh, yeah, that
if
was one of the best.
If you guys have not seen that, go watch it. It was so crazy. I cast that with Wolf. I thought Classic had that game won straight in the back, but unfortunately for Classic, it lost it.
That was an insane game, Matt. Definitely go ahead and check out that bot if you haven't seen it. But guys, we are gonna take a look at our maps. The same bands.
The same order. Yeah,
different order in the bands, I suppose, but the same order as you were saying for the maps that we are gonna be playing here.
Yep, so starting off at King's Lady Drum Station, followed by Frost, and if needed, we will be going to Frozen Temple.
So this is gonna be a bit different, obviously, a totally different matchup, PvP, a mirror matchup here. And I just kind of want to see what Seed is going to bring out, because when you're facing Classic, a guy who's recently a GSL champion and also recently in fantastic form, you got to prepare some kind of builds to take out this monster.
Yep. And we all know how creative Seed is as a player. He first introduced us to hallucinations, because you have to remember back in Wings of Liberty, he actually had to research hallucination. And, he's just a very creative, smart player.
That he is, whereas Classic, just kind of a macro beast. Who's going to take game number one? Let's find out right now on King Sejong Station.
Spawning here at the top left as the blue Protoss from MVP Chicken Maru. It is...
MVP Chicken Maru, Seed.
There's Seed.
Looking focused.
Yep. And spawning here at the bottom right. That was a bit premature.
You want to just get it out of you as soon as possible. I almost said Maru, because it says Maru on a shirt. Anyway,
let's go check Maru sometime. Anyway, bottom right here, spawning as the red Protoss from SK Telecom T1, GSL and SSL champion.
SK Telecom T1, Classic.
Actually, in the studio, there's like a black square.
Yeah, it was kind of covering the players' faces in the intros.
You guys don't see this, hopefully, but we watch on the big screen because it's just so much bigger. There's us as well.
They came from Ulsan.
Ulsan, that's like 3 hours, 4 hours?
Yeah, to the south down there. I think it's somewhere down
near Busan. Yeah. It's like north of Busan.
Yeah.
I still got
near Daegu,
yeah.
Somewhere around there.
I wanted to go to Busan, but unfortunately didn't have the time, didn't have the money to go. I'll come back though, probably go to Busan. Jeju as well.
I'll be back.
Yeah, I'll be back. I'll be back, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, didn't go to Jeju, but still want to go there. Have you been to Jeju or Busan?
I've been to Busan once. Busan was beautiful, man. The beaches.
Yeah, especially if you come around this time.
Oh, yeah.
It's pretty good.
This is the time where you got to go. It's like so humid. You just want to go into the water.
But you got to go before it's too hot. That's the thing.
Yeah. Spend like 5 minutes outside. You burn your whole body. gets pretty hot over here.
As both players are scouting each other. Seed's actually going for the quicker Mothership core. Classic going. Oh, both players going for the two adepts. Actually, we're gonna look through this. I think it's easier if we look at this monitor.
Mm.
Yeah.
There's a lot of gas there, saved up. It looks like just for that later Mothership core. And we'll see if he's actually gonna cancel it and put down a Stargate here. Classic doing a bit of wonkiness, I suppose, in this game.
Yeah, and notice that Stargate from Classic, as you mentioned. Curious to see whether it'll be Oracle or Phoenix. It's a very flexible building that you can get. Depending on what you see from your opponent, you can get one or the other.
Yeah, and I was wondering what tipped him off exactly. It's going to be a very fast Stargate. When you do forego that Mothership core and forego that safety, you can squeeze that out a bit faster. So perhaps he wants to go for a fast Oracle. Or let's see if he scouts the Stargate here. Maybe he would go for Phoenix.
Yeah, let's see how much damage this Adepts can do from Classic. He actually gets nothing done, which feels like a waste, to be honest.
He does scout it, and he does start the Phoenix.
Yeah. I mean, that is the just desserts for sacrificing your Adepts there.
Yeah, for sure. Well, the Adept here from Seed going to try to get his own bit of scouting information, but isn't going to see much outside of a gateway wall.
Yeah, and that Adept from Seed is going to die. Seize the free gateways, though, which is always a positive for Seed.
Let's see if he can sneak himself in here. I think he was actually trying to hide this Adept in a weird spot on the map, but it is going to be found here. He's not going to be able to scout as long as this Mothership core stays in position.
We see the quick Oracle as well as the robotics facility from Seed. He wants to do damage with these two buildings. Is he taking his Nexus or those are the units at his expansion? I can't really see.
Both players taking their Nexus right now.
Yeah, yep.
About the same time. But Classic, he is going to be very happy when he sees that Seed, in fact, did commit to the Oracle.
He's going to completely shut down his Oracle. And the question is, how much damage can Seed do with that Oracle? Or if he sees the Phoenixes, will he just run back and save the Oracle for another time later on in this game?
May want to do that. Let's see if they pass in the night, and they do. Uh-oh. Classic not in position. He will have the overcharges, though, back at home, as well as a Stalker.
He has a Stalker, but will it be enough? The Mothership core looks to be out of position.
Yeah, where is that Mothership core?
Oh, he actually goes for a tag rather than the attack. That's quite surprising. He probably wants to see what's happening in the main.
Yeah, I think that must have been a mistake. Or maybe he just assumed that the Mothership core was there.
I think he was scared that the Mothership core was nearby. But he does. Did he see those Phoenixes come around?
I believe he did. Yeah. Now he's sending this Oracle all the way up to the top right and just going to hide it for a while. Yeah. As you're saying, just kind of leave it out there. But it is going to be found, unfortunately. And this Oracle is going to do no damage.
Yeah, unfortunate there from Seed. This Oracle gets completely shut down. He only gets two tags off, but honestly, quite useless tags.
And now he's going for Phoenixes of his own, which actually surprised
me. Oh, no, this is not what Seed wants to do right now.
Oh, Classic, he doesn't lock, though. He doesn't chase the Phoenixes. He probably could have gotten both of them.
There is the numbers advantage here from Classic, so he should be able to snipe at least one of these Phoenixes, but the overcharge does go onto the pylon. Oh, and the Stalkers get some nice hits onto the Phoenix of Classic. Those are, like, a few weak Phoenixes right here.
Yeah, for sure. Kind of unfortunate he wasn't able to snipe that Phoenix. I was saying I was surprised that Seed was going to follow up with Phoenixes because whenever you get behind in Phoenixes, it's very hard to catch up. You need to make a second Stargate. You really need to commit if you're going to do it. But, I mean, he already knew. He already saw like 3-4 Phoenixes from Classic but still went for it.
Yeah, and looks like both players... Oh, actually, double Stargate here from Seed, so... If we see that Fleet Beacon go down, we could see that Anion Pulse Crystals for the Phoenix Range.
Yeah. And this is kind of what you have to do. If you're going to commit from behind, you need to make a second Stargate, and you need to try to catch up that way. Whereas Classic, he's showing signs of already wanting to transition. putting down a Twilight Council.
Yeah, really nice harassment from Classic. Picks off a few probes, a couple probes rather, and looks like Seed is positioning to take his own third base. But there is that, it feels like there's a vulnerability here from Seed. He could just, because he's trying to pull all these Phoenixes, there's not enough ground units being invested for Seed. And if Classic sees this, he could do a lot of damage with the ground army of his own.
He definitely can. I'm curious to see how Classic is going to follow it up, because I think he did go in there and scout that second Stargate. Maybe not, actually. We did just get a shot of it, but I didn't actually see it. But he's going for Blink, and he's adding a bunch of gateways, as you were saying.
Yeah, and on the other hand, Seed is going for those quick immortals, but immortals to accompany this double Stargate Phoenix play. And we haven't actually seen Classic take a third base yet. Maybe he wants to kill him right now.
Looks like it. Committing to a ton of gateways here. He is going to have the higher Phoenix count, even though Seed did go for the double Stargate. So.
And Seed, I think Seed has a feeling that this is happening, and he's stopped that third base. He's going to scout out with those Phoenixes, see if he can pick off any stray units. But it looks like Classic is positioning here, timing that push with the Blink upgrade.
Yeah, this is a really nice read from Seed, as you were saying. Just shut down the third base. You got a pylon wall. You're making immortals, too, if you can squeeze out a bunch of them. There still is so many stalkers, though. Let's see how Classic wants to engage here.
Yeah, I think one thing he definitely needs to do is pick up the immortal, but here comes the attack with the Blink from Classic.
Coming in, trying to focus down these units. The big lift on the immortal, as you were saying. And with the double overcharge, he is going to back outside of it, but he's not going to let up on the aggression. He just wants to wait until those run out and then re-engage here onto Seed.
Yeah, and here comes the actual Blink itself. So let's see how much damage this attack of Classic can do. Another Immortal does come out, though, for Seed, which is a very nice touch to this defense. Oh, is he actually going to Blink up?
Looks like it. He's got a sentry in there as well. He could force field the ramp, and there it is. Going to just try to fight against these Phoenixes, and that's going to be an easy win in this fight for Classic.
Yeah, really nice move there from Classic with that sentry force fields onto the ramp, and I think enough damage has been done here by Classic to win this game.
Even the probes being pulled here, trying to micro in and out of the War Prism even.
War Prism does get taken out though.
Yeah, not really going to work out for him, in fact. Going to Blink onto the Immortal though. And a big warp in and a second Immortal comes out here from Seed. Maybe an overcommitment by Classic.
Yeah, that's actually quite unfortunate there from Classic. I thought that, I think once that War Prism died, and he couldn't warp in any units. Also, he had, three, four Stalkers inside that War Prism. He couldn't really win that fight. If he still had those three or four Stalkers, I think he could have had a chance killing Seed off there.
Yeah, for sure. And now we're in a very interesting spot in this game where things just kind of settled down. Very similar supplies here for both players. Seed does have the bigger army, and he may want to get a little bit feisty here, maybe go for a couple of drops and try to do some damage to Classic as well. He wants to take back control of the map from Classic.
Yeah, but Classic is taking his third base. I think Classic feels very confident that if he takes his expansion here, he knows that Seed probably isn't going to attack, so takes that third, actually cancels it. Okay.
Yeah. He sees the late response, perhaps, or maybe saw the army moving out there. He's got an observer in position.
Unpowers those two warp gates, and that's very unfortunate for Seed. What? Okay.
Yeah, they're kind of just going over
there. They're just chilling there. Maybe he wants to surround with the probes.
This is a scary army here from Seed. Classic has to deal with this.
I think he wants to use those probes to surround this army because he knows that this is Seed's last chance of winning the game. Oh, but nice counterattack here from Classic with these four Stalkers.
Hey, he's still doing damage here, really shutting down the economy of Seed. Not much mining in the main anymore. And he's going to Blink out and save a bunch of those Stalkers as well. And Seed, it looks like he actually wants to back off here, perhaps.
Yeah. Doesn't want to go for the kill. I guess he saw that Classic is has a nice army to defend from the incoming attack that Seed was planning on doing. I look at the unit count. What is it? 7 Adepts, 11 Stalkers against 2 Immortals, 10 Stalkers. So a very gateway heavy based army from Classic.
Yeah, I like the fact that he switches into the Adepts too. I forget who said this, but recently in Pro League, a Protoss was saying, maybe it was Hero. He's like, no, you just make a bunch of Adepts with the Glaives, and because they're light units, neither the Stalkers nor the Immortals, which is, you know, the bulk of Protoss's army here in the mid game nowadays in PvP, are going to be able to do any bonus damage to you.
Yeah, and we actually see a Void Ray coming out from Seed. Probably wants to use that to shut down any War Prism harassment that Classic is thinking of.
For sure, and we do just have Classic now backing off. He has retaken that third base, getting that up and running soon, no doubt.
It's very strange to see that we're 12 minutes into the game and we haven't seen a lick of a third base at all from Seed. So definitely wants to power off these two bases and try and kill off Classic before the army of Classic gets that third base up, but also the army of Classic gets too big enough for Seed to deal with. But look at the supply count though.
Yeah, I mean, Classic definitely ahead, and you see that Seed is committing to double Void Ray here. I wonder if that's a response to the large number of Adepts that Classic is making, or maybe that's just him saying, I've got these two Stargates, I want to hit a two-base timing, I want to all in here. I'm not really going to be able to take this third base behind, so I might as well just try for this.
Yeah, I mean, Phoenixes aren't really going to do anything against the composition. Maybe you can lift up some Immortals, but that's about it. Void Rays, very nice against those armored units such as the Stalker and the Immortal. And it's also very good at sniping the War Prism if he decides to do so, which I think he might do in this battle.
Yeah, Classic gonna have to identify that and keep that in the back. He's had some trouble in the past with that.
Picks off a few Stalkers there. Very nice move with the Force Field from Classic. So this battle's all about positioning, honestly. Whoever gets the better concave will win this battle.
Look at how many centuries Classic committed to. He's got 8 in this army alone. Warps in a 9th one.
That was a very bad move there from Seed, and all these force fields just going around, and Classic just has too much here.
Yeah, really nice force fields from Seed to try to cut off those Adepts, but as you were saying, it looks like it's just too much here for Classic. Gonna shade in and blink in as well.
Yeah, unfortunately for Seed, he doesn't have that blink technology on his own Stalkers. He's not gonna be able to move back position his army and blink forward, this should be the game.
Looks like at the blink on top, GG, Classic takes game number one.
Yeah, very convincing game there from Classic. Seed didn't really have any sort of answer to the the heavy gateway army that Classic was building upon, and you know, very nice job with those blink Stalkers early on to get that advantage, stop that third base, and once Classic got his own third base, he was able to power up and take the game.
Sure, Seed having a bit of a rough time in that one. Decided to commit to the Phoenix battle. It didn't quite work out. Classic with a nice response. And then Seed from behind trying to go for the all-in. Did not work out.
Yeah. Void Rays didn't really do the job taking out that War Prism. And honestly, it's just too much army from Classic for Seed to deal with. It's a numbers game in the end.
Now we're going into Classic's map pick. It's going to be Frost, a big map. Classic, I'm sure he's very confident in his macro play against someone like Seed, who he definitely should see himself as the favorite player here.
Yeah, but got to remember, this is a four-player map, and in my opinion, four-player maps are very prime for creativity, so we could see something funky from Seed, especially when he's a game down.
Maybe he'll channel some SOS, hide a hidden base, proxy Stargate. We could see anything at this point. Let's see what's going to happen here in game number two between Seed and Classic on Frost. Down here in the bottom right in the blue, it is
MVP Chicken Maru C.
I love the smirk.
Seed a very cool guy.
Fun, very calm, very collected.
Yeah. And down here in the bottom left in the red, he is
SK Telecom T1. Classic.
First player to ever win both a GSL and SSL. Classic, he actually used to play Terran in Wings of Liberty and then switched to Protoss. Can you name any other significant race switches?
I think there have been some from some, you know, weaker players.
Neeb,
yeah,
Neeb
he did
Neeb
as well.
Is wrecking right now.
Yeah.
Hero used to play Zerg in Brood War, but then he switched to Protoss, but I think that really counts.
I mean, Mauro.
Mauro, he plays everything.
He was all over the place for a while.
Mm. Anyway, coming into this game, we do have those horizontal spawns, so it's gonna change the dynamic of this matchup between these two.
Looks like Classic gets the lucky scout here. Actually gonna send it directly to the base of Seed, where Seed goes the wrong direction. And maybe when he sees this probe, he'll be like, oh, if you scouted that early, you must be in the bottom left. And he can just redirect that probe. So it's not going to be all too much of a difference here.
Yeah, it's the probe's going to get to the base of Classic. just in time before the units do come out, so it's not going to fully... Classic's not going to deny the scouting of Seed with the probe that's coming. Actually, no, he's deciding to scout the top left.
Yeah, he actually doesn't redirect that probe. Yeah. More concerned about trying to block in the probe there and kill it here in his own base.
Yeah, but Classic is playing it very safely. He's getting that really quick mothership core. He's also getting two adepts. Seed, he doesn't really know what's happening right now, so he's doing pretty much... Actually, no, he's getting the two Stalkers instead of two Adepts.
And this is the thing about four-player maps. If you don't get that information and you do commit to the scout up to the top left and you scout him last, then you're almost definitely going to be denied the scout. And Classic already spots this probe.
Yep, and Seed is completely in the dark right now.
All he knows is two Adepts were made. That's about it. He doesn't know the follow-up. He doesn't know if there's an early base.
So lucky there from Seed. If he moved those Stalkers maybe 2 or 3 seconds earlier, that probe would have gone into the base.
Yeah. The timings of StarCraft.
Yeah, I mean, StarCraft is a game of seconds.
That it is. And these Adepts not quite able to get into the base for a scout. They're trying to find an angle here, but the Stalkers are on top of it.
Yeah, Seed's completely on the ball with those Adept Shades. Completely shutting down what Classic's trying to do here. As we look at the build orders developed so far, looks like pretty much similar build orders, both getting that really early Nexus. Actually, the Adepts get in.
The Adepts get in, and they try to shade here for that extra scout. It was shut down nearly entirely. I think it got one probe and a decent scout at the back.
Hmm. And the Nexus of Classic is slightly earlier. And actually, we see Twilight Council come here for Seed. Maybe he wants to apply the pressure with the Blink.
Yeah, it could be the blink or perhaps like weirdly timed DTs with a drop. Classic has had a lot of trouble against DTs in the past. I remember a game where he was very far ahead of SOS, but then SOS made like DTs at like minute 10.
Yeah.
And then he just started wrecking the economy and Classic started freaking out and went for an all-in across the map. He did win the game, but it nearly took the game from him. So could be a good read by Seed if he wanted to go for it. But
well, the question is, okay, he's going to get the Observer first, which is the safer move rather than getting the Immortal. He does have these sentries here at the front, so obviously if any attack does come from Seed, he can use those sentries to force field and defend. He's also got those two pylons at the front for the Photon Overcharge, and we're going to see the Phoenix being hallucinated from the sentry to scout what Seed's doing.
The immediate follow-up there of the Immortal, once to get that out, will be good against Blink Stalker play. And so far he's in the dark, but he's about to figure out a lot here with this Phoenix if he pushes it.
Yeah, I mean, the Phoenix is very pensive from Classic. He actually sees the not only the Twilight Council, but he also sees it's being Chrono boosted, so he knows an upgrade is coming.
Yeah. And all the Stalkers, too. If you're going for Glaives, you're not making that many Stalkers.
Yeah,
so.
And I'm pretty sure it's not Charge being upgraded from that Twilight Council.
What a world we would be living in if that were standard.
Yeah. As a Classic, just mainotting his probes to his expansion. Same with Seed. And look at the income count from both players. It's very even. But Seed is 6 supply behind. 7 now, saying that.
It looks like Classic is moving out to these ramps because he wants to force field the ramp so that he can't be blinked upon. But he's actually sitting at the wrong wall.
Oh, is he going to force a panic overcharge here? Okay, Seed's smart enough. He's just waiting for what this Oracle's going to do. Nice scout, though, with that Oracle. Sees what Seed is doing so far.
Finds the Blink Stalkers here. They don't have Blink just yet. And Classic actually loses that trade, loses one of his own Stalkers.
Even though the Stalker count is low, you have to also remember Classic does have the sentries with the Guardian Shield, so it's going to mitigate a lot of that damage, and also the two Immortals just worth their weight in gold against a massive Stalker army.
And the response here from Classic is Blink and a Forge. Oh boy. Seed, you really need to be careful.
Yeah, you don't want to be losing Stalkers one by one here.
Is for sure. We already do have the Forge up here for Seed, in fact. He already started the plus one, so feeling a bit safer than Classic in this game to commit to those upgrades. Generally, you go for the Forge when you're like, okay, I have time. I know he's not going to be attacking me. I can sneak this out in my build.
Yeah, it looks like both players are very content just sitting on these two bases, trying to eke their way to third base, Even though Seed did get the earliest blink, he's not really done too much with it so far. Just very scared of his army composition that could just completely wreck him anytime if he misdoes a blink.
Yeah, and you see Classic moving down to that bottom ramp, you know, outside of his natural.
Well, actually, here's the engagement, and you got to remember, Seed did blink away, so he's, Classic knew that there was an opportunity to take out some Stalkers. Very nice move there from Classic.
Yeah, Seed still staying on the map as well, but what I was saying is I'm surprised he doesn't try to blink into the main, perhaps, and get some harass damage. We saw Classic do that in the last game, but Classic's positioning actually was denying that a little bit because he was sticking around the bottom side and saying, go ahead and try to blink. I'm going to catch you before you even get there.
Yeah, but now Seed's army looks pretty bulky. He's actually ahead on supply. Looking at the army count, 57 to 54 so far. And Seed's doing a very nice job just keeping Classic into his inside of his base.
That he is. Now that Classic has the blink, he might be a bit more confident. He also has the much earlier third base. Looks like Seed putting down a pylon at his third base location. May want to get that up here in a bit, but Classic definitely going to be ahead there.
Yeah, really nice scouts here with the hallucinations from Classic. He doesn't have to force his way through with an observer. Just keep the observer with his army. And now he's starting to add a depth with that resonating glaive upgrade as well.
That he is. He did that in the last game. He's only got six now, but he can get a couple of big warp-ins in to try to get that in here. And generally, once you get to decently even-sized Protoss armies in a PvP, it really just comes down to the engage and, you know, where they have the engagement, who's got the better positioning, the concaves, defensive advantages as well.
Oh, Classic's trying to pick off some units there, but fortunately doesn't get anything. And unlike last game, Seed does have a few sentries to his army composition. Like, well, there was sentries in the army composition for Seed, but it wasn't as significant as it is in this game. And Seed's trying to harass with these four Stalkers.
He's going to get two probes, but that's about it. He's going to pay for it in...
Oh, and a sick move here from Classic. Blinks forward ahead of the Stalker of Seed just to try and catch it off guard and uses the Stalker to block it. Very Warcraft 3S move there.
Yeah, nearly gets it.
Oh, doesn't want that. You don't want to do that, Classic. Loses a few... Actually, no, here comes the hallucination.
Yeah, but the rest of his army coming in here, the Hallucinated Archon's going to tank a lot of damage here. And a blink forward, so many force fields from both these players.
Yeah, and Seed's actually got a very nice concave, but he is being surrounded from these adepts of Classic.
Yeah, that's pretty huge. And now Classic on the chase here. It looks like he's got the slightly bigger army. He definitely can blink in. Just a better engagement overall. The surround, the Hallucinated Archons.
Yeah, the Archons did a very nice job tanking a lot of the damage before Seed could react to it and stop attacking the Archons. And he's still attacking the Archon. You don't want to do that, Seed.
Yeah, now he's going to come in here, even fight under the Overcharge and the Time Warp.
Oh, nice pickup there from Classic with the Immortal. Drops it with the War Prism. And
he doesn't have a second Force Field, so he can't pick off that Immortal, kind of. Disappointing, but it's okay. I mean, he did win that engagement overall, and he does have the earlier third base, so...
Yeah. That being said, though, Seed is still in this game. He does have his third base up and running, and it's not a significant army count from Classic that he's able to run over the army of Seed. You also have to remember that the upgrades are pretty even. Both are on plus two for their ground units.
Classic deciding to go for the plus one armor before that plus three attack. It is cheaper.
Yeah.
Get it out faster. I think it's a nice idea in general.
Yeah, and looks like... No, he's actually Classic going for that plus one armor.
Yeah.
And Seed's not doing anything with his forge anymore, so... probably wants to invest that money into getting more units. Because he knows he's in a very tough position right now.
We're going to see some harass here from Classic. Wants to drop at the natural and perhaps shade in with two more adepts into the third. They were just chilling over there on the right side of the map. I can't imagine any other purpose they would have at this point.
Yeah, and Classic's finally adding the gases at his third base. So he wants to get those high-tech units out that are very gas-intensive once those gases do come up for him. But it looks like Seed's actually posturing to do some sort of attack here.
Yeah, that he is. And let's see what kind of angle he wants to take here. Wants to come from this bottom ramp. In the meantime, a big pull, 10, 11 probes here at the base of Seed going down.
Yeah, this is going to trigger Seed's attack. Oh, a couple Stalkers lost for nothing. That's actually a few force fields, I guess, but Actually, Classic is relentless with this War Prism harassment. Yeah. These Depths do so much to the probes.
It's so smart from Seed. I mean, look at how many kills. This one Adept has 10. He wipes out the entire third base.
Oh my god, sick force fields there. Trapping the army of Seed, in that narrow choke point.
Generally, in PvP, you don't want to attack unless you know you've got a big advantage. So Classic just waits back, he harasses, and Seed is forced to attack. But how do you attack into this?
Yeah, it's a ticking time bomb here for Seed. He lost so many probes from that harassment of Classic, and as long as Classic can reinforce his army, keep defending, use those pylon overcharges to his advantage, he's going to be able to win this game.
And that he can. Even Adept's coming in, trying to shade in onto those Immortals. Nice micro into the War Prism there by Seed, but I think Classic just has way too much once again.
Way too much, and way too many probes have died for Seed. Sure, Seed's going to, he might win this battle, who knows, but the thing is, he has no economy to back this army up.
Yeah, just so many Immortals left over here for Classic. The Zealots being warped in. GG! Classic gonna take the 2-0 victory.
Yeah, like that Lucera game against Beyond, Classic playing very convincingly, taking those two games in a pretty straightforward fashion, and we're going to see Lucera against Classic in those winners' match.
It's gonna be a really nice match there for sure. Classic said in his interview that he's very confident against Seed. Just this one player in this group who he felt he could definitely win against.
Yeah,
and
it was obvious.
He 2-0's him. He crushes him.
Crush. Yeah. And Seed, not really what... Honestly, he is the dark horse of this group, so not really what we expect from him.
Yeah, so there you have it, guys, the 2-0. We are going to jump into our third match of the night, the winner's match, Lucera versus Classic, after another quick break. Stay tuned.
The only one. Your name has been paroled throughout the lands you have controlled. We look up to.
그대로 맑고 깨끗하게 피어나라고 겨울을 이겨낸 봄꽃이 내게 말했다. 맑고 깨끗한 칠성사이다.
Jumping in, eh?
리액션 아닙니까? 변신! 아닌데 야 팔이 이렇게 고정되어 있잖아 이거 아하! 어 그래! 이게 어플 되는 게 스노우엔만 가능해요 아, 이거 히트 치겠다 여기가 바로 나의 축제! 온다! 가! 야!
오늘은 바베큐 장난 아니야 삼정살 오겹살 야 어머어머 웬열 진짜 맛있어요 오겹살 삼정살 쌈장 딱 해가지고 웬만하면 참으려고 했는데 메타그린이 같이 있으니까 먹어도 됩니다 밥이다 오늘의 주인공 하루치는 세정 메타그린과 함께 다음주에 쿠키 쫙 빠진 저희 모습도 기대해주시고요 안녕
거의 게임 마스터. 무슨 게임을 하더라도 뭐 기본 이상.
네. 제가 그걸 연습할 때가 아닙니다. 그렇습니다. 이렇게 하는 거예요. 이겼나?
이겼나 이거?
추가 시간. 좋아 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 좋아.
자리야 킬.
나이스. 아, 나이스. 아. 와, 드디어
팀이랑 닮았다는 소리는 좀 듣는데 LW팀 소개합니다. 저를 키우는 게 보통이 아니거든요. 파이팅! 나이스! 공한 번 뜨죠.
한번 죽였어요.
나이스!
와! 이겼어. 야! 어디?
게임 방송에서도 할 의향이 있어.
방패 정도는.
아, 우리 범 선수에 다시 한번 박수 주면서.
저 박수를 한번.
이거 팀장 미팅이냐?
이게 뭐라고 그렇게 긴장이 되죠?
느낌 왔어! 자, 들어가자. 지금이네! 마무리야!
오버워치
파이팅!
우리 올리브 영에서 드디어 루이조를 변화시키기 위해 우리 아프리카와 함께 루이조 변화시키기 대장정이 들어갔어요. 이게 스타일 업무 제품입니다. 오, 피부 밝아지는 것 같은데? 와, 이런 게 올리브 영 클라스구나. 라마? 라마? 라마띠. 와우! 영국 스타일. 근데 멋있네. 나가면 번호 따일 것 같은데? 여기서 마무리할게요. 우리 제품은 올리브 영 제품이었습니다.
올리브영 플러스 유소나 예뻐져라 뷰티 방송. 홈쇼핑 아닙니다. 첫 뷰티 방송 시작하겠습니다. 달콤한 꽃에 겹겹이 둘러싸인 듯. 아, 여러분, 이 모든 제품들은 올리브영에서 살 수 있습니다. 새로운 네일 아트로 사랑을 표현할게요. 감사합니다. 고맙습니다. 세상에.
미소가 생기다. 화사함이 생기다. 건강한 하루가 생기다. pH 8.0과 풍부한 미네랄로 핑크빛 생기가 생기다. 아이시스 8.0. 이제 모두 핑크하세요.
답답할 때 마셔봐요. 트로피카나. 상큼상큼 과일 듬뿍 스파클링.
리얼 프루트를 스파클링으로.
과즙이 톡톡 쏜다. 트로피카나 스파클링.
상쾌하면 되는 거야. 상쾌함의 높이가 다르다. Stylish Sparkling Water, Lotte Trevi.
봄꽃에게서 듣다. 있는 그대로 맑고 깨끗하게 피어나라고 겨울을 이겨낸 봄꽃이 내게 말했다. 맑고 깨끗한 칠성사이다.
Welcome back, guys, to the GSL Code S Group C. We're about to jump into the winner's match. We did just have Classic 2-0 seed here. The winner's match is going to be Losira versus Classic.
Yeah, and Losira said in his interview that he was actually least confident against Terran, so he completely wrecked Vion in that first game, so if he's very confident against Protoss, I'm pretty sure that Losira has a very good shot of beating Classic Hill.
Yeah, and what I would expect from here, to be totally frank, I think Classic takes this one, and then Vion defeats Seed, and then actually Losira and Vion will rematch in the final match. And because Losira already took a 2-0 against him, he must be feeling very confident against Vion at least today. And so he must be feeling really good about his chances here tonight. You know, he's got a good chance against Classic. It's not, you know, 100% that Classic is going to win this one. But even if he does lose against him, he should feel confident against the other two players.
Yeah, well said. I mean, whoa. So we actually see Judgment today. Everyone, tell your friends, we're seeing Judgment.
GSL Judgment, it's Judgment Day. Here we go, guys. We did have the other bunch of maps, Frost, GSL Rockshear, Dust Towers, and New Gettysburg banned out. So we're still going to be seeing King's Haven Station and perhaps Frozen Temple if it goes to Game 3.
I'm so excited for Judgment. Let's think of it as Frost had a baby with Dust Towers.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually a very accurate description. If you guys haven't seen it just yet, we may or may not get a CG up there trying to explain it, but you'll see it in the game anyway. You'll be learning it with us. We haven't gotten to see a pro game on it just yet, so.
As both players are preparing for the first ever match on GSL Judgment, Losira against Classic. You think Losira Classic's gonna win it?
I think between these two, I would favor Classic. He seemed very confident coming into this one, but Losira's definitely got a chance. I mean, anything can really happen. Also, if he says he's very confident against Protoss
yeah.
now,
I feel like Sarah happen. Has that chance, but that is just talk though, so who knows what's going to happen.
Perhaps. Guys, we're going to jump into set number one. GSL Judgment is the map for Lucira versus Classic.